esteemed participants, course participants of the 23rd NIAS course for senior executives, associates, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. This is the occasion for the fourth Dr. Raja Ramanna annual memorial lecture. And we have a very distinguished speaker this evening, Dr. Anil Kakodkar. The last 3 years, when we started the series, we had first Professor C.V. Sundaram, a close associate of Dr. Ramanna and friend, to give the inaugural lecture. And subsequently, we had Sri Shyam Saran and Dr. Chidambaram. To talk to you a bit about Dr. Raja Ramanna, Professor B.V. Srikantan is here, a close associate again and friend of Dr. Ramanna for very many years. So let me now request Professor B.V. Srikantan to say a few things about Dr. Ramanna from his very many years of association with Dr. Ramanna. Professor Srikantan.
Dr. Kakodkar, Dr. Kasturangan, Sangeeta Menon, ladies and gentlemen, I had a very long association with and Mrs. She has not come yet. Dr. Ravida Ramana's daughters are here. Mrs. Ramanna and the other daughter are expected to join us soon. I had a very long association with Dr. Raja Ramanna, starting almost on the day he landed in Bombay after completing his PhD from the London University at King's College. And this association continued for almost 55 years, first at the Tata Institute of Fundamental Research, and later on, of course, he moved to the Atomic Energy Department. But he continued to be a faculty member and professor and head of the Nuclear Physics Division of the Tata Institute of Fundamental Research. And Dr. Raja Ramanna's life is very, very interesting for anybody because he was not only a scientist, but he was also known from a very young time as a musician. Actually, he used to play on the piano in this auditorium also till his last days, actually. We always remember that because we did not have a good piano here, but he would take the trouble of getting one and playing it here for us. And also, Raja Ramanna, you know, started his piano lessons when he was very young. He was still in the school. And it so happened that the same piano lessons which he learned and which he was trying to play at a guest house in Mysore, put him in contact with Dr. Homi Bhabha. It so happened that once when Bhabha and Mrs. Wadia were staying in the Mysore guest house, state government guest house, one morning they heard somebody playing on the piano downstairs. And when they came down, they saw this young man of about 18 years or so playing on the piano, and Dr. Bhabha was very happy with listening to him and also and asked him what he wants to do. By then he had got admission for pursuing a career in music in London, but Dr. Bhabha told him that he could do that, but he would like him to, because he also told him that he had completed his master's degree in physics from Madras University. So he gave him immediately a Tata Fellowship, and then Dr. Raja Ramanna went on this fellowship to England, and he completed his PhD. That's a very interesting aspect of his life. In fact, had Bhabha not met him that day, he says in his autobiography, he probably would have become more a musician rather than a scientist, because his leanings at that time were more towards music than towards science. But we should thank this particular meeting for the emergence of a very important scientist in the country. As you all know, Dr. Raja Ramanna has been acted in very many capacities. He was the director of BRC, and he later on was also the defense advisor to the Ministry of Defense. And later on, he was also, during the time of V.P. Singh, a minister for science and technology, deputy minister, for about a year or so, as long as V.P. Singh's ministry lasted. And after that, when he came back, he became the chairman of the Atomic Energy Commission. And after he completed that, when he was retiring, Mr. J.R.D. Tata persuaded him to take on the challenging work of his dream project. His dream project of J.R.D. Tata was setting up of an institution of this type where there could be could have both humanities and sciences together, and also interaction with the industries and so on. We have explained to you yesterday the objectives of this institute and how J.R.D. Tata was his own vision, and how Dr. Rajaramanna played a very important role in the beginning. And he also ensured, right in the beginning, the cooperation of many of his friends in building up this institute. You know, Professor M.N. Srinivas was, you know, a very famous anthropologist whom he brought here. And then Professor C.V. Sundaram, who gave the first Rajaramanna Memorial Lecture, also came here. And then there was one Professor Kapoor, who unfortunately passed away last year, who was formerly in NIMHANS, and he also came here. And all of us together built this institution in the early years in a way that probably is very different from the way many other institutions have grown up. So it is very appropriate that Rajaramanna's memory is perpetuated by having this annual lecture every year by a very distinguished scientist or whoever was known to him very well. So I'll stop here because time is restricted. Thank you all.
Dr. Kasturi Rankan for welcome remarks and introducing Dr. Anil Kakodkar.
Good evening, and let me join Professor B.V. Srikantan in welcoming all of you to this Dr. Rajaramanna Memorial Lecture. And I should say that I came in contact with Dr. Rajaramanna as a young scientist from the Indian Space Research Organization. I was sent to Delhi to discuss with him, no, to Bombay at BARC, to discuss with him the possibility of detection from space of atmospheric nuclear explosions. And we made a proposal to him and presented to him at his BARC office. And I still remember the rigor with which he reviewed this entire proposal and the in-depth understanding that he displayed on several aspects of the concepts that we tried to present to him in context of developing a space system. Something like what the Vela satellites did way back to look at the atmospheric nuclear explosions. But since then, I have been in touch with him, even though I was junior in the overall hierarchy. But whenever I met him, it was always a great moment, a memorable moment to see him, talk to him, and also engage in very high intellectual activities. And of course, this contact continued even as I became chairman of ISRO, and subsequently when I became the director of this institute. He welcomed me, he was very happy that I took over this particular institute, and really gave me quite an amount of orientation of how this institute is so different from what I am accustomed to in the context of India's space program, and he was very true. But alas, within 6 months of my taking over, I lost the benefit of having an interaction with him. I consider as a big void in the context of my own understanding of the subtleties of running this institute, because I know that as a first founder director, he really introduced several items on the activities of this institute, whether it is a Wednesday lecture, whether it is an associate program, or other kinds of things which Professor Srikantan mentioned. So in a sense, what you really see as a NIAS culture today owes much to his conceiving what this institution should be. And as you told yesterday, it was not all that easy to translate the vision of J.R.D. Tata of a multidisciplinary institute into a reality, but he nearly succeeded in doing that. And that's where we revere him, we remember him, and this particular lecture, as Professor Srikantan brightly pointed out, is in memory of his contributions and everything that he has done to this country as an illustrious son of this country. Today we have with us Dr. Anil Kakodkar as the speaker as the tour delivering the Raja Ramanna Memorial Lecture. Of course, in one sense, I don't think he needs any introduction to this audience. He has been in the news, and also he has been very well known in the context of his contribution to India's atomic energy program. But I'll just go through some aspects of his career for completing the overall program. Dr. Anil Kakodkar, he was born on 11th November 1943, joined the Baba Atomic Research Center in 1964, following the 1 year postgraduate training with top rank in nuclear science and technology in the then atomic energy establishment. He became the director of the BARC in 1996 and took over as chairman Atomic Energy Commission and secretary to the Government of India, Department of Atomic Energy, in the year 2000. Dr. Kakodkar obtained his BE Mechanical Engineering degree from Bombay University in 63 and MSc in Experimental Stress Analysis from the Nottingham University in UK in 69. Dr. Kakodkar's professional career is primarily involved with the research and development work related to nuclear reactors. Dr. Kakodkar's decades of dedication and pioneering efforts in indigenous development of a large number of critical systems of Indian pressurized heavy water reactors, his contribution to safety-related research, and his piloting of several new state-of-the-art technologies for this reactor system have significantly contributed to our self-reliant capability in the area of nuclear power reactors. He was among the chosen few involved in the first successful peaceful nuclear explosion experiment that India conducted in 1974 at Pokhran. And later, he played a key role in the series of successful nuclear tests conducted during May 1998, again at Pokhran. The Indian Atomic Energy Program has seen several new initiatives under Dr. Kakodkar's leadership. These include several new projects for augmentation of the nuclear power capacity, augmentation of uranium and zirconium production capacity, and launching of first commercial fast breeder reactor. These initiatives will take the power generation capacity from 2,700 megawatts to around 7,300 megawatts, besides considerable enhancement of energy potential of available uranium through the use of fast breeder reactors. The comprehensive and robust program under Kakodkar's leadership has earned India a distinctive status as a country with advanced nuclear technology, and our nuclear program is at a stage when India is confidently engaging the international community to secure a rightful place for itself in and to open up international civil nuclear cooperation. The deployment of technologies for better quality of life for our people has received considerable boost under Kakodkar's leadership. Besides energy, these cover radiation processing of food and agro products, agriculture with emphasis on oil seeds and pulses, healthcare, particularly involving cancer, urban and rural waste management, and desalination of water. Dr. Kakodkar continues to be actively involved in programs related to the augmentation of thorium utilization in our nuclear power program and leads the team engaged in the design of the advanced heavy water reactor. He has created a roadmap for shaping the third stage of the India's nuclear power program aimed at tapping the vast energy potential of the thorium resources, not only as a source for electricity production, but also as a primary energy source. A number of new technology areas such as accelerator-driven systems, high-temperature reactors, materials and recycled technology, etc., have been nucleated for this purpose. He has, over the years, built competent teams of highly specialized scientists and engineers in the reactor engineering program. He has brought out more than 250 scientific papers and reports on the various aspects of his work. He has several academic honors. I will only say a few of them. Doctor of Science from IIT Mumbai, University of Mangalore, Guru Nanak, and so on. Doctor of Literature from Goa University and many other universities. Academic fellowships on the Indian National Academy of Engineering, was its president, the Indian Academy of Sciences, the National Academy of Sciences, Maharashtra Academy of Sciences, and so on. And he has also the highest civilian honors, Padma Shri and Padma Bhushan. International recognitions include recipient of Rockwell Medal for Excellence in Technology in 1997, honorable member of the World Innovation Foundation, member International Nuclear Energy Academy, member Council of Advisors of World Nuclear University, member International Nuclear Safety Advisory Group, and other assignments include, of course, chairman of the Board of Governors of the Indian Institute of Technology currently, and of the governing board of the Inter-University Center for Astronomy and Astrophysics in Pune, and also the chairman of the Research Council of the National Geophysical Research Institute at Hyderabad. Personally, I have been associated with Dr. Anil Kakodkar for quite some time as the both in the capacity as heading the Indian Space Program, and we had to work together on several issues, and later on even as member of the parliament, because I wanted to make sure that whenever I make a statement, particularly on the 1-2-3 deal, I would always seek his advice, his views, and they always proved to be very useful in making a point in the parliament. And so I should remember those many hours of discussion I have spent with him. And even today, when we meet together, I think it's a delight to discuss with him many issues that confront science and technology activities in this country, on which he has excelled himself through both being an active professional and a high-quality leader. It's indeed our privilege to welcome him today, and I call upon Dr. Anil Kakodkar to deliver the Raja Ramanna Memorial Lecture.
Dr. Kasturi Rangan, Professor Srikantan, Mrs. Sangeeta Menon, Mrs. Ramanna, distinguished participants to this course of senior executives, ladies and gentlemen. First of all, let me express my very sincere and very humble gratitude to NIAS, to Dr. Kasturangan, and to all of you for this opportunity to present the fourth Dr. Raja Ramanna Memorial Lecture. This allows me to pay my respects to the memory of Dr. Ramanna, whom I would say, if I had to identify one individual as someone who has been the most important mentor or someone who has the most significant influence in shaping myself, I think that person is Dr. Ramanna. And that, after taking account of the fact that I never worked directly with him, I have been all along in the reactor engineering program, and of course he has been our boss, but then I belong to a different stream than the stream of science that he was interested in. But in spite of all that, I had very close relationship, close acquaintance, and in fact very frequent interaction all along in terms of various things, some connected with atomic energy program, some even outside. So I think it's a very important opportunity for me to be able to present this memorial lecture. Before I get into the topic which I'm going to speak on, science for national development, I thought I'll just mention one one anecdote that will sort of a further continuation of what Professor Srikantan said and what Dr. Kasturirangan said. And this was in connection with, one day I got a call from Dr. Ramanna's office. So I went there, met him, and he says, a week from now, we are going on a foreign tour. We're going to Egypt, Austria, Vienna, and then Poland. And you are coming with me. I had absolutely no inkling or clue about what the programs are. And even till today, I have not been able to figure out why I was called or why I was included. I in fact asked him that what is it that I am expected to be doing, or and he said, no, you just come, that's all. So there I was, and that was a program which lasted, I think, around 10 days. And at every step, when he was interacting with people from other countries, after the interaction, he would give us some tips. You know, you should do like this, you should do like that. This is how the international politics works. And I think the insights that he gave, not just at that time, but all along, have made me much better in terms of understanding both the how the world moves and also how the international community in particular moves. In the same visit while in Cairo, he had an hour to spare, and so he decided that he would go to a museum. He had one of his students who had done PhD under him, so he said, I will take you around. So we went to Tutankhamun Museum, and he asked him, shall I hire a guide? So he laughed and says, no, guide is not necessary. I know what I want to see. Last time I came up 2 years so and so. It was at such and such place. So let us go straight there. And then we'll go as far as the time permits and leave. And believe me, he used to see an exhibit and say, now we are going to see this, because he had read the whole thing. And virtually it was there in front of him as pictorial memory. And now we should see a chair, and now we should see some very fine gold beads, and now we should see this, like that, you know. And at times, if he's not able to, he would search that out, and surely that thing was there. And that was his, and of course, he did say that understanding history is important, and he had that. He was a man of many dimensions, which we all know. So the 1 hour was over, we came out of the museum halfway. This is the rest of it I'll do next time I come here. And then he asked this person who was taking us, his student, now you should be clear that after I retire, if I need a job, I can come here and be a guide. So that was his competence. Dr. Ramanna was, of course, a scientist par excellence. He was also a science manager par excellence. And I cannot talk about his science because I am not competent in that area. So I thought I should choose the other part and talk a little bit on science for national development. Now, it's clear that any developed society or a developed country, I think pursuit of scientific research is a cultural necessity, as important as pursuit of other art forms, pursuit of sports, even pursuit of spirituality and what have you. And the things beyond what we do for earning our livelihood and earning our day-to-day living. And there are many other higher aspects of life, and clearly, as a society, I think pursuit of scientific research, because that's how the human civilization has grown, by learning things around, understanding things around, and improving quality of life by way of better understanding, and through that understanding, creating better support systems, better facilities, and so on. So this is one part. Of course, the other part, again, as a cultural necessity, is what Jawaharlal Nehru has been always saying, the scientific temper. Unless you have a good scientific activity around, some of the members of the society can be a part of it, some of the members can be watching that from outside, but that's necessary. And that's one important ingredient for a good scientific temper in the society as a whole. So that, I think, is clear. And so just as pursuit in music or dance or dramatics gives us a special happiness, special joy, pursuing research does give us that special joy. What I'm going to talk today is the other part of it. It's the science which also leads to technologies and improvement in quality of life, as I said. And that requires a particular way of organizing both scientific activities and also related translation of the scientific output into whatever that may be necessary for the development of the society or the country. So it's a question of solving the problems of the society to support economic development of the society. And now, clearly, just pursuit of science, while it may give you ideas, it doesn't allow us to solve the problems of the society. If you want to have science-based development, you have to pay attention to what I call an RD cube chain, research, development arising out of that research, demonstration of some application arising out of that research and development, and after having successfully demonstrated on some reasonable scale, actual deployment of that application either in the society, then you judge the success from point of view of how much contribution it makes to the society, or in industry or the commercial world, where you judge it on the basis of how profitable, what kind of business, what kind of returns such a development produces. But it is this entire translation, research, development, demonstration, and deployment, that one has to pay full attention to if you want to make a success of deploying science for development. Now, this I think is very clear, everybody understands, but very difficult to implement in reality. And in fact, I would not hesitate saying that for a large part, not 100%, but for a large part, there is in fact a disconnect between the scientific research that we do and its translation into into robust commercial applications. I'm particularly talking about the new innovative technologies which can put the country on the cutting edge. And the problem is the following. The problem is the linkages between people who carry out technology development and people who carry out research. Even if I take the example of my own department, Department of Atomic Energy, we're very proud that being a mission mode organization, we have developed in a very self-reliant manner, robust, commercially successful technology. We are running industrial enterprises which meet all parameters of the commercial world. They hold the AAA rating of these rating agencies, CRISIL and others. But if you ask a question, how much of it is based on the original basic research in the country, and how much of it is based on borrowed ideas from technologies developed elsewhere? I think an honest answer would be that we have done well in the research. We have our research is internationally competitive. We have made great contribution to publications in a variety of fields. But the technology that we have developed is essentially built around ideas which are borrowed from elsewhere, and not ideas which are generated from the new knowledge, new scientific research. Now, there are exceptions. I'm not saying this is 100% true, but this is by and large true. Look at the scene in a so-called technologically advanced country. In a technologically advanced country, the new technology emerges from nowhere. There is nothing parallel to follow. It emerges from the frontline research that is taking place. You know some effects, you understand those in greater detail, you make devices using those effects, and then you build systems and technologies around those devices. And it is development of such technologies that gives you the cutting edge, that gives you the leadership position globally. And I think India has come to a point where we can always say, you know, we're on par with the best in the world, we claim. Our PHWRs have been recognized world over, received awards from World Association of. So we are, you know, if you say how many countries are there who have full capability on all aspects of atomic energy, you will find 4 or 5 countries, and India is one of them. And I think the same is true in many programs. Department of Space, DRDO has done many other activities. But I think now time has come when we should look for number one position. I'm not saying number one position everywhere. It's a highly competitive world, and everybody is competing. But there should be some areas where we get number one position. Now, how do we get number one position? Number one position can never be realized by developing technologies on borrowed ideas. It's not possible. It's obvious. So if you want to get number one position, you have got to build completely innovative new technologies which are based on latest scientific accomplishments. And that requires, see, today what is happening, we do a lot of research. All goes into publications, which is the way it should be. So we are contributing to the global knowledge pool. The technologies are built on such knowledge. Now, while we share the scientific research quite freely globally, technology is not shared. Technology you share only on the basis of some commercial gains, some political gains, some military gains, and so on and so forth. So when you have to acquire technology, you have to pay, and pay heavily. Or, of course, you develop technology where you can never. So either you acquire technology or you develop technology, you can never become number one. And I think, as I said earlier, India has come or reached a point when we should target ourselves to be number one, at least in some areas. And to be able to do that, we have to short-circuit this movement, this chain of research and development coming through Indian research, coming back to India through other countries. I think we have to short-circuit that to Indian research feeding into Indian technology. And if you do that, then we can close the gap between research and development. Very important if you want to take leadership position. From development to deployment, in between there is a demonstration stage. I think our country has to still realize that the amount of work that is required to be done is in fact many times larger than the first development, the work required for first development or first demonstration in a laboratory of a particular scientific principle. In fact, Dr. A.S. Rao, who led the electronics program in AET at that time, in fact, I would say electronics program in the country, he was also the founder and mentor of Electronics Corporation of India Limited. He has gone on record at some stage. He in fact quantified that once a particular equipment is developed in the laboratory, from that stage to taking that equipment to the commercial market, he says that whatever is the effort required for building that first laboratory prototype to the commercial prototype, commercial robust product, the additional work required is 20 times the work that is required for the first development. Now this may vary depending on what you are talking about. It may be 10 times, 20 times, 5 times, whatever. But the fact is that that effort is much, much larger. And this, unfortunately, again, is not realized in our country. We have, for example, Technology Development Board has done wonderful work. But we require activities similar to what Technology Development Board is doing, multiplied by, I would say, at least 100 times. If we want to really benefit from the strong research capability that exists in the country and the strong R&D base that we have. And we are now talking about not just R&D in the government, but R&D in industry and across the board. Because again, as I said, in the competitive world, if you have to march ahead, then it is necessary that there should be more and more products coming as products developed in India. So there are these gaps in this RD cube chain, and I think we need to pay attention to this. And to my mind, the difference between the success of the quote-unquote mission mode organizations and the general program in the country is precisely this. In mission mode organizations, not that these gaps don't exist, they probably still exist, as I gave the example of atomic energy. But there are efforts to bridge that gap. There is a constant kind of attention to maintaining continuity of this effort to translate this development all the way up to robust deployment. And now the question is, can this translation be done only in mission mode organizations, or can this also be done in any environment. You know, you don't see this. You see many, many programs outside. They develop commercial products in universities. They develop commercial products in other R&D labs. And many of them are small. You don't see organizations containing 10, 20, 30,000 people. There are several small labs they're operating, but still they're able to achieve. And I think the difference to me, to my mind, is there are linkages. In many times you use this term backward and forward linkages. I think the linkages that we have in our science system are kind of parallel tracks. We'll have a program of research. It will be linked with corresponding collaborators elsewhere, internationally. So you look at matching interests and that program goes on, which in fact is extremely important for flourishing research. But what I'm talking about is the linkage perpendicular to these linkages. Linkages between the research in the universities and the development in national labs. Linkages between research in universities or research and development in national labs with R&D in industry, and so on and so forth. And if you develop these horizontal linkages also equally strong as the vertical link, then we'll eliminate these parallel tracks. In India, a lot of work happens as a parallel tracks which never meet. And I think one of the important aspect that science managers must pay attention to is to make sure that the so-called parallel and cross linkages are fully developed, because it's only then that one can make sure that we would have this continuity between different elements of this RT cube chain in a proper manner. Now, having said that, how does one influence both excellence in each one of these aspects, excellence in research, excellence in development, excellence in commercial deployment of these technologies? See, they require different value systems. Something which you consider extremely important parameter, measure of excellence in one area is not necessarily, in fact, it's not appropriate for measuring excellence or parameter of excellence in another area. But the success lies in ensuring excellence in all these areas and also ensuring linkages. Again, the full matrix should be completely linked. So we need to create drivers. We need to create motivations for people and also the organizations to connect with each other and also work in a manner that it stands at the highest level in the respective yardstick of excellence. And I think the most important parameter that could drive such a motivation is the funding. Now, I want to look at both the funding that one carries out or one sees being carried out in agencies abroad, the funding that one sees being carried out in agencies in India, and whether there are some some important points that we can derive for the further strengthening of this matrix which I am talking about. See, when we have, as I said, when we have these linkages, the scientists, we, you know, we look for our collaborators, we look for opportunities to work together. Now, a scientist in a country X would obviously be pursuing program which receives proper funding in that country. Scientists in country B, again, likewise. And also in India, a scientist would work on programs where, of course, first of all, it has to be of our interest. But then if you have a lot of interest in an area where there is no funding, it's very difficult to sustain scientific or research activity, particularly if funding requirements are large. Fortunately, in India, we have a very liberal view of science funding, and the funding has gone up substantially. So strictly, in my view, I don't know whether everybody will agree, but in my view, availability of funds for pursuit of scientific research is actually no longer an issue, particularly for good scientific research. You can get funding for practically everything. In many of the institutions abroad, the science funding is defined on the basis of some thrust areas which are well publicized. There are areas which are well funded. There are areas where, in fact, the funding is throttled because they think that we must shift gears and move on to newer areas. And I am aware, and I'm sure you would be aware, that the scientists do change tracks. They do change their field of work. Essentially, it is driven by funding. And I have no difficulty with either of the methods. But look at what happens in terms of the thrusts or emphasis of scientific research that we pursue in India. We have funding for practically every area. In other countries, there is a very selective funding. Collaborations can happen only when there are mutual interests, which in turn would mean that even scientific research or the priorities of scientific research in India would be driven by the priorities elsewhere, simply because these collaborative channels because we have only parallel channels, we don't have strong cross channels. So I think, I want to put it to you and you can think it for yourself, but it looks to me that in terms of priorities, we are more driven by the programs elsewhere than programs in the country. Fortunately, in the field of scientific research, all countries are moving on the state of art or the current interests, and so it is not such a big issue. It's not as if, you know, because if you pursue this international line, you're obviously on the frontline areas. And so you can continue to do good scientific research. So that is the good part of this happening. But the weak part of that is there are many areas of technology where you may not have all the information set complete. If I am to give a classic example, and I'll give an example completely away from my field so that I'm not misunderstood. Take the case of thermal power plants. And thermal power plants strictly involves entire thing. You know, if you talk about combustion, you can start from very fundamentals all the way to robust technology. There's everything involved. And I think same is the case if you talk about combustion, if you talk about corrosion, if you talk about materials, if you talk about turbulence, I think there is scope for this entire thing. But the fact is that not that work R&D work goes on in India also and in thermal power plants. But if you ask a question, what is the key Indian issue that needs to be solved as far as thermal power plant is concerned? I'm talking about a coal-based thermal power plant. To me, the key Indian issue is to be able to run a combined cycle plant with Indian coal. Now, there is a complete void because Indian coal has a high ash. The gas that you will produce by burning Indian coal, it has kind of impurities which are not exactly identical to what you would get if you burn a high quality coal which is available in many parts of the world. So there is a material issue, there is a corrosion issue, and we don't have enough knowledge base in the country for completing the robust development. Luckily now a project is being implemented, but I suspect that it's not being backed up by the strong research base that it is necessary. And why that is not being backed up? Because there is no scientific interest in doing that. Because if you ask in turbulence, what is the interest? Turbulence, everything is solved, one would say. In corrosion, what is this? Everything is solved. Because this is not a part of the frontline research globally. And so it would not attract. In a mission mode, we have got to do it, so we force people to do, so they do. But as a part of national scientific program, we have left these weak areas simply because, and ignoring the fact that they are of a very crucial importance for national development. But at the same time, we have left those voids and marched on somewhere else. Now, this is the problem of driving priorities. And I put it to you that in today's world, when scientific research is being looked at on a multiple scale, people are trying to connect research from the scale of subatomic particles all the way to large crystals and physical objects. I think there is a lot of opportunity to do that. But then the question is, how do you create priorities? How do you create motivation? And this is an issue that I, in my view, again, has not received the attention that is due to this, but extremely crucial in terms of driving the scientific activity for national development. By way of adjusting the Indian policies for funding, we can certainly make some improvement. I think that's something that needs to be done. There are many other issues. In fact, if I turn to mathematics, cryptology is one such issue. I think we have very strong base in mathematics. In fact, we have strong base in cryptology. But in terms of cryptological tools, and Dr. Kasturangan knows it too well, he has addressed this issue himself, there is a gap. And so I think we need to look at various things that are necessary to bridge this gap, and certainly funding is one such thing. At this point, let me come to also this question of linking up the research in the or the government-funded research or public-funded research with that of the industry research. And I'm very happy that in this audience there are a significant or a large number of people from industries. There is actually a correlation. See, the industry research industry is by and large, while the government research may be driven by, as I said, it's a cultural activity, so it should be a culturally important activity, so it should be funded and supported. It's also a national development activity, so we should support this over a long period of time. So as far as government funding is concerned, it's clear. But if it comes to funding an activity which will see the benefits of that research over a very long time span, maybe 10 years, 15 years, 20 years, to my mind, it is unthinkable that an industry corporate would fund such a thing. Some very big giants may still do. For example, Bell Labs and people like that. But I think we have miles to go to reach that kind of enlightenment. Industry, by and large, would prefer funding those aspects of research which will produce return in a reasonably short time. And reasons are not just that I have funded so much, I must get return. The reasons are also because industry has to also worry about their competitors. In government research, the research in one lab, in fact, becomes complementary and supplementary to research in another lab. In industry, research in one industry and research in a competitor's industry, they have a cutthroat competition between them. And any research which goes on for 10 years, 15 years, can never remain secret. Industry, of course, protect it, but still, over such a long period of time, it's impossible to protect. So it would appear as if the research investment of one industry may, in fact, benefit research investment or research output in other industry if the scientists in the other industry are smarter. And this happens. So industry tends to fund research on a somewhat shorter time horizon, where they can quickly churn out products. Now, how can they do that? They can do that by riding on the output of research which is public funded. And this is what happens world over. You have, in terms of the, call it core technologies, or in terms of basic aspects of R&D, you have public funded research. And so that industry, and that could be then whichever industry, they may be even competitors of each other's, but they can pick up from some higher pedestal because there is so much of work done by way of public funded research, and then quickly sort of bring in their own input and churn out a product and realize the benefit. And this is a very practical way of both an accelerated industry participation in R&D, as well as Indian industry becoming more and more competitive globally. But this means that the government or the public funded research should be in those areas which are of great use to Indian industry. And again, the question of driving priorities and thing of the like that comes in the picture. Now, this is happening on a kind of a case-by-case basis. You look at some requirement, then you say, okay, you go ahead. So we have these isolated cases where we're pushing on. I think what we need to do is to look at it as, planning commission activity, something of that kind, where you can drive the whole S&T system to create this maximum benefit for industry. And luckily, industry is now alive to R&D. They also realize that for their survival, R&D is important. But there is this little fine-tuning that is necessary. So this is one part of it. The second part of nurturing the cross-linkages, as I call it, is to structure organizations in a, and I I often take the example, I have in fact, engaged myself in a lot of discussion with many people. Supposing I look at it, whether BARC, if we have to design BARC today, And I'm saying example of bark because bark is, in many respects, a very unique organization. Bark will, you will have a very significant basic research. They are also churning out new technology and products, but the by and large the nuclear reactor and fuel cycle program, particularly of the first stage, has come about as a result of R&D in BARC. So there is that major R&D framework that also exists in BARC. BARC also runs industrial activities. All the reprocessing plants are in BARC, all waste management. These are all huge projects comparable to, in fact, some of the larger industry. They are certainly much bigger than what one would call a medium scale industry. And there are not one, there are several projects. So BARC is unique in the sense it has basic research, which is open-ended. It has R&D, which is focused to meeting requirements of a mission. And it has a regular deployment activity right inside BARC. So it is in that context, if I ask a question, that supposing I were to design BARC all over again, of course, we can't do that for BARC. We can't carry out such fundamental restructuring of an old organization. But we are now setting up a new campus of BARC close to Vizag. And it was in that context that we went through this question. And it now looks to us that we should in fact think in terms of co-located institution. Co-located institution with different frameworks for the academic activities and basic research activities. The best framework is that of a university, or a best framework is that of some of our fundamental TIFR, for example. But obviously that framework is, according to me, not good enough for supporting large-scale technology development. And for large-scale technology development, the current framework, of course, there can be fine-tuning, but by and large, that's an ideal framework. So imagine you have two co-located institutions which are a part of the same apex body, which are a part of the same mission, but their governance structure is different. A university-like structure for the academic and basic research part, and a national lab-like structure for the technology development and implementation part. People who join such an organization, I think we should leave them the choice which structure they want to belong to. But at the same time, we should also encourage, permit these people to work across. It's not that somebody belongs to the university or academic structure. He has no role in the technology area. Or for that matter, somebody who's in a technology area, he can also come and carry out teaching or carry out guiding research in even basic sciences. And I think this is eminently possible. It looks to me that Dr. Bhabha, when he visualized, of course, Professor Shikantan is here, he can throw more light on it. But it looks to me that Dr. Bhabha, when he had TIFR and then he created BRC again in Mumbai, and it's the same leader, but he created two different structures for BARC and TIFR. The same leader who had several people working on both sides. If we nurture that kind of an arrangement, and in fact if we create an ambience, and particularly the institutions are co-located, it's possible to create that ambience. I think these horizontal linkages will get better established. And once that happens, I think there is a greater chance of the cutting edge research getting into cutting edge technology. And so this is what we are going to attempt. These things take time. So whether it is successful or not, we'll know only after 10, 15, 20 years. But I'm pretty confident that such a model will work. There's another thing that we can do, and we are in fact doing, and that is the creation of this Homi Bhabha National Institute. At this moment, the Homi Bhabha National Institute, it has come into existence some 2 or 3 years back. It already has, I think, more than 500 PhDs carrying out research under its umbrella. Very soon, maybe another 3 or 4 years, you would find HBNI churning out PhDs in hundreds. But that by itself is not, that's happening many other places. After all, HBNI students are the students of different research laboratories and autonomous institutions of DAEs, where the research was anyway going on. People have been doing PhDs, so that's not the big deal. The big deal is HBNI in its charter. While of course it will continue to support academic activities of the kind which has been taking place traditionally, but its emphasis would be on research on the interface. And the research on the interface could be of various kinds. It could be an interface between two disciplines. It could be an interface between, as I said, to connect this or facilitate this translation. It could be an interface between some activity in basic research and a related activity in terms of developing applications out of that research or connected technology which can arise out of that research. It could be interface between institutions. And in fact, for supporting such a research, we are in fact saying that a student would have two guides, one in the basic research area and one in the applied research area. And now these are all pipe dreams. So it's very difficult for scientists to work together in our country. But I think students can be cementing force, and we are looking at this possibility. So we expect at least some fraction of the PhDs would come out of HBNI, who would have deep insights into the basic part of science which which they are working on, but at the same time they would have actually participated in translation of that into some technology. They would be guided by two people who would obviously come from two different backgrounds. They may have slightly different value systems. I'm quite conscious of the fact that this is bound to create a lot of tensions. But I think if we have to make progress, we must manage tensions without, of course, allowing tensions to create breakdown. And that will be the task of people who are mentoring or managing HPNI. Once that happens, I think quite apart from the fact that we will have now people who can dwell on both sides. They won't feel that if I'm working on one side, the other side is alien to me. They will know the language of people on both sides. So we'll have individuals which are much more special in terms of supporting national development. So this is the first gain. More importantly, a student will have one link with a basic research institution because he would have his teacher there, and one link with technology institution because he would have his teacher there as well. And the student, I think this simple factor could also trigger a lot of other collaborations between the two scientists across this institutional interface, or currently I will call the institutional divide. So that's another gain. And so it looks to me that this, and I'm sure I can give you a few more examples, you can yourself visualize many examples. But we need to discover such arrangements which would create the what I call the orthogonal linkages, not just linkages in research separately and development separately and commercial work separately, but also linkages which translate along the RD cube chain. And if that happens, I am pretty certain that we would have made a great difference in terms of making impact of science for national development. Now, I mentioned this, that this is bound to create a lot of strains, a lot of tensions. And this will happen because, and this happens in BARC every day. How do you judge a scientist? Or how do you compare two scientists? Somebody who is in research, so you look at his publication record, what kind of journals he's publishing in, what kind of areas he's working on, what do his peers have to say about him. He's a technology man who has built a very robust and successful technology. He has no papers, he has no publication. Now, how do you compare such apples and oranges? And so it seems to me that we need to develop these yardsticks. Now, a simple way of looking at it is, after all, whether it is publication or whether it is technology, what you look for is the impact. If you have done something which has no impact on anybody, then many times it may so happen that that work may be great, but it doesn't get seen by others, so it doesn't make impact, and hence it gets lost. Now, just as we talk about the impact of basic research in terms of the impact of publications, and there is some way of, there are many ways of doing it, but you carry out an assessment of that impact. It seems to me that for somebody working on applied research man essentially generates data. He generates data to fill the domain for development of robust technologies, because you require a lot of material data, a lot of process data. So you require a lot of information of that kind. And unless you have a full data set with you, you cannot be talking about a robust technology. And that is what the applied researcher does, in my view. So what is his impact? According to me, I look at impact of this on impact on the downstream partner or the upstream partner. Everybody, if somebody is working in an applied research area, there must be somebody downstream who should say that I am looking for what he's doing, and it is very valuable. Because otherwise it is just one another data. Somebody has done some measurement at such and such conditions of pressure, temperature, if somebody else has done similar data at some other pressure temperature. In terms of the research impact, it's very little. But in terms of applied research, if there is some downstream work as a part of the national priority which is going on and which has made a valuable impact, I think, and of course you need significant output, then it has made an impact. And that one could develop parameters on such impact. When it comes to deployment of technology, I think the measurement is simple, how much profit it has made. If the deployment has made good money, good profit, the impact is maximum and reward. And the challenge lies in doing this. I was talking about a same institution if it is BARC, if it is co-located institution, if we're talking about the new framework that we're trying to create at Vizag. But I think it should be possible for us to do this across the board, even if there is a cluster of several institutions connected through this translation across the RD cube chain, we should be able to look at this and respect scientists on the basis of their impact. I think we need to create systems where a basic research scientist, of course, he has to be respected for his achievements in basic research, but he should also get huge respect in the technology and industry area because he can make valuable contributions to those areas. And similarly, a technologist or an applied researcher should receive respect in basic research programs because he can bring in a very enriched perspective in terms of this translation but he should be able to talk the lingo of the basic research community. If you ask this question whether this is possible today, the answer is no. I think it's a big no. We need, of course, it's not possible to do this for everybody. But if we can create a situation where at least a reasonable fraction, maybe 20%, 30% of our scientific community can dwell equally proficiently across the interface, I think things would change. And we should be in a position to create such conditions even when you're talking about a conglomerate of several small institutions working on a program. Now, there may be some may be in government, some may be in industry, or all may be in government, or all may be in industry. That doesn't matter. And this, I think, to my mind, is very important. And I think the examples are not far to see. You see in foreign universities, Nobel laureates, whose invention are in fact the basic or the basic cause of very successful industries, where the Nobel laureate himself would be the chairman of that company. He spends very little time on that, but there is a whole technology activity nourishing on that. Can we create that condition in our country? I think that is the challenge, and if you do that, then I think we can certainly move forward on our dream to take India to the topmost level. Finally, there is a question of compliment. While we do all this, it cannot be done in a laissez-faire manner because other countries are anyway doing this. So there is a competition. And if you don't win that competition, then in fact, in terms of the bridging the inequality in society. See, for example, we do technology to create wealth in the society for the development. And we also want to do, we're also talking about these societally relevant activities because you want to uplift the stock of poor. Now, so we should expect that science and technology should in fact create more equality into the system. But the competition that runs is in fact does exactly the other way. You can, those who are very aggressive in their technology development, they will also market that technology. And those who are not so aggressive, they will lag behind. And this in fact can create, instead of creating balance, can create an imbalance. And so I'm going to end my presentation with a quote from an article in Science and Technology as a Tool for National Development in Third World Countries by Volubu Jude Tadev. But I think what the words are very important, so I have picked them up and I want to read and end there. And it reads like this. Science and technology has shrunk the world both in time and in space. In turn, this has brought the world to a state of perpetual conflict. As a result of apparent underdevelopment of some parts of the world by others. Proponents of dependency theory attribute the widening gap between developed world, the North, and the underdeveloped world, the South or the Third World, to science and technology. Yet, it is this very science and technology which is looked on to deliver the Third World from the claws of underdevelopment and to bridge the development gap. So that's another aspect of what the scientific community needs to do in terms of national development. Thank you very much. Well, that's a very important issue, but a completely different issue. I think this challenge is there before all of us, and there is. I'll respond to this in two parts. One, of course, the gradient in terms of the monetary returns or compensation that one gets. If one gets into research vis-a-vis one getting into IT or business or whatever. Now, this fluctuation is bound to happen, and that gradient has a strong influence in driving young students towards the career they would choose. So that's a hard reality. We cannot wish it away. And the only way is to make careers in science that much more attractive. Efforts are going on, government is conscious about it, our Prime Minister is particularly conscious about that, but there are limitations. And even if something is done, there will be always this, I don't think we can level this gradient completely any time. The only difference is you go through this cycle. When the industry was in a boom and where to the fag end of the previous pay commission period, the gap was very large. Now to in the beginning of the new pay commission period in the industry is down, so the gap is small, but there is a gap. So it goes through these cycles and we have to address that challenge. But I think there is a more fundamental issue. And the fundamental issue is the following. You look at the independence movement of India. At that time, the people who really fought for freedom, they, according to me, did the most important job, if you can use that term, for this country. And nobody compensated them. There was this elite part of the society, there was other thing. They also had their fora. They have also made some noises about independence. Maybe they also had better influence in the powers that be. So they have contributed. But I think in terms of the level of contribution of the people who had done in a selfless manner without worrying about what happens to them or for that matter what happens to their families and children, that number is very large. And we owe to them that we are independent today. So there were people who were charged, who were fired. They didn't worry about this question of whether if I get into independence movement, will I get the same thing, or if I get into a British Raj job, I'll get a better deal. They didn't worry about this. So there was some other driving factor which was... I think today we are on a similar threshold in terms of technology independence. Not many people realize this, but imagine, I said earlier that we are now looking at living in a liberalized world. Everybody is free, and we are also a part of that decision. Everybody is free to market their products, free market society. Obviously, who would win? Who would earn more money? Who would be in a position to pay more money? It would be those who would have superior technological products and market them at a cheap cost. Now, if we don't play our cards well, so far so good, but if we don't play our cards well, I think we may become, in fact, talking earlier with Dr. Kasturi, he used the term, we may get into vulnerabilities. And it is quite possible that if we don't pay attention to these factors, we would get into vulnerabilities. And in fact, we would lose our technological independence. We may sign out several things without our knowledge, permanently preventing us from getting into that technological area, and so on and so forth. Now, there is an aspect of this at the policy level, and also you need people who understand and are strong enough, they have the backbone to put the country's requirements up front. That is one part of it. But we also need technologists, we also need developers, we also need scientists. Who would, in fact, you know, one is to protect, but other is you must have technologies. You create protection and don't develop your technologies, then again the game is lost. So you need people who would develop these technologies. And I think it is as much a part of ensuring our technological independence as participating in freedom struggle was before 1947. It also looks to me, you look at, I think many of our eminent scientists, you took the name of Sir C.V. Raman, Meghnad Sir. I think in terms of, you look at their contribution to freedom movement, they were all fired by the need for freedom, need for, you know, independent India and all. So they had that spirit. Unfortunately, today's young generation, that spirit is lacking. And that is lacking thanks to our education system, thanks to our family system. I think this is nowhere in the talk. We don't talk about it in our families. We don't talk about it in our schools. So how do young children know? They respect people who participated in freedom movement because they got freedom. But they don't know that they have some role. They have to do something. Now, if they don't know, how can we blame them that they are moving to greener pastures? They will. So I think it's also important for us to create this awareness. And I have seen the young children, particularly the impressionable youth, if they get fired on these aspects, they in fact drive themselves into. And there are examples, very few, who have, even after passing out with flying colors, even in institutions like IIT, they have engaged the whole life in social service. There are a few examples. But I think see, in our education system, it has become so much oriented towards towards technology, management, and all. And then when we talk about humanity, we're essentially talking about personal management and industrial resolution of industrial disputes and that kind of thing. There are higher aspects of humanities. They're missing from our education curriculum. So that, I think, is also an as important aspect as... But I think I wouldn't blame young people for going up. Why should they not? I think it's our fault, and we need to correct it.
Dr. Govardhan and Mr. Vinod Chennai in that order.
I'm Govardhan from BARC. Sir, my question is related to the people's issue. When we want to develop basic sciences and applied research, we need the right quality of people getting into these areas of work. And we need that they stay there for a reasonable amount of time. Now, what in your opinion we should do as a country as a whole to motivate people to join such programs and further them?
Two parts. One, I think I have attended several student programs. If I go to a college in the city of Mumbai, sometimes there will be crowd, sometimes there will be no crowd. And whenever there is a crowd, certainly there is that crowd is not because they have interest in science. It's for some other extraneous reasons. You do the same thing in villages. And you would find, if it's a very small village, there is a limit to how many children are there. But near 100% will appear. The interest in science in the village students, even today, is at a very high level. So I think we need strong activities to nurture that interest and bring them into R&D or scientific programs. But that is only one part of it. There is equally important second part, and that is in terms of mentoring. I think it's extremely important that the scientists or researchers, or for that matter anybody, it's true for all organizations, not necessarily only for research and development, at all levels in an organization must take mentoring as their prime responsibility. Unless there is emphasis and strong attachment to mentoring your younger colleagues, again, why should we blame them for leaving? And again, this is not necessarily connected with only R&D. It is true for any organization. So mentoring is very important. I think this aspect of mentoring is not at the desired level. It's there. It's not that it's not there, but it is not at that level. We need to have much more efforts in terms of mentoring students. Since this is Dr. Raja Ramanna Memorial Lecture, I must give you an example of Dr. Ramanna as a mentor. And this belongs to Pokhran days, the 74. We're obviously working in the field. One day it got very late. In fact, it was well past midnight. We used to get calls, why are you not returning, come back, everybody is already finished dinner and what are you doing there? Now we couldn't obviously say on telephone line what we are doing and why we are late, but we said, okay, don't worry, you will come back. You go to sleep, we'll finish our work and go back. And actually there was no problem, it was just sometimes things take time, that was the only thing. We returned back to the base where everybody was staying. the whole base was dark. Everybody was asleep. There was only one individual who was awake, and that was Dr. Ramanna. And he, it's not that he was anxious about what's happening. It's so anxious because why these people have not come. He has asked me several times, what do you do in your leash? He has never asked me, what do you do when you are in the bark, when you are in lab? But he has asked me several times, what do you do when you are home or outside the office hours, what do you do? And he has always found fault with me because I am not engaging enough in other aspects of life, which of course he was a full person. Now, so these are the, you know, you have to connect, and you have to connect not by way of a debating session. You have to connect with the younger colleagues on a heart-to-heart wavelength. And then the mentoring is at its best. So I think we should ask ourselves, how many of us can connect with our younger colleagues heart-to-heart? And that's the important aspect of mentoring. And I think we should, that's a very important thing.
Vinoshana from Hindustan Petroleum, Mumbai Refinery. When you were referring to RD Cube, I was time and again recalling our experience in the oil industry. I have been in forums like the Scientific Advisory Committee, where there is a robust process to put the basic research and applied research through the other Ds of development deployment with the time-based funding and cross-functional labs involved, and also through the CSIR initiative of Nimitli, where Dr.
Marshall. Yeah, Nimitli is a very good example.
Yeah, and I found that it was one of the most powerful way of combining towards an outcome-based this thing. So I think robust models are already at work, so probably.
No, I agree with you. The difference is, see, these are activities which are single project oriented. Now, they will certainly produce results as far as that project is concerned. The question is whether they will also nurture a value system which will ensure a kind of a permanent framework for nurturing such connectivity. Or for that matter, once you have got into this linkage, have you created activities in the related basic research for all time to come? Have you created several component technological capabilities which can also be reconfigured for something else? So these are of course good example, and I think that is where one has to start. But what I'm talking about is creating an ambience which is permanent, and but decidedly that's an important example.
Dr. Samadhan and then General Sundaram.
Sir, myself Dr. Samadhan from Department of Science and Technology. Sir, I am associated in a public-private partnership implementation of a program on drugs and pharmaceutical research in DST. Every year more than 100 crores we are investing in these creative linkages. Sir, my concern is, last 20 years I have been working in DST, several secretaries who have worked in these mission-oriented departments like space and also atomic energy, we have DRDO, some scientists, they have become secretaries. Every one of them transferred some good culture of administration and management in the department. Now, my concern is, you have touched wonderfully the need of linkages in the country. My concern is, how to bring this mission-oriented working culture in the scientific community, because when you link public-private partnership, I think university and CSIR labs or some other institute to an industry. these people are unable to get their culture, and how best we can, transfuse this mission-oriented working of R&D. That is number one. Another thing, sir, when we think of partnership, I feel that you have rightly said co-located model of institutions and labs is doing well. It is, at the same time, I feel the funding agencies, from the beginning, if they carve a budget for collaborative inter-scientific agencies functioning, if you start from the root, there could be some, impact. Now, what we do is only the numbers we take from the various sources, fund goes from a one department. It has not been able to, even limitly, several things have gone, reached the logical conclusion. So what do you think about this co-sharing of budget by the scientific departments to bring, the kind of linkages grid in the system?
Well, first let me clarify. I think the mission-oriented departments, atomic energy, space, DRDO, etc., that's okay if you define a mission and you want to implement the program. But I'm not for one bit suggesting that the entire S&T scene in the country should be structured like that. What I'm emphasizing is the so-called linkages, linkages between the research community internationally, linkages between development community, linkages between technology community. These are one which are already existing. I'm now talking about horizontal linkages, linkages between research community and the development community and on to technology community. And this can be, the only point is in a mission mode organization, this is more easy to achieve. It automatically happens. But it is unthinkable that the entire country's S&T scene can be structured only like that. If you do that, I think you would do a lot of harm to the scientific development, because I think it is important that you have a large number of discrete institutions autonomous by themselves. And I think that we should not harm. What we need to do is to make sure that they are linked in their programs, and not an institution A may be linked with institution B for, let us say, a part of the program. It may be linked with institution C for some other part of the program. Same thing may happen with B and C. But on the whole, you should see this matrix complete, the vertical and horizontal linkages complete. If we put this entire S&T scene in country into a set of defined mission orientation, you would find 10 years, 12 years down the line, if you want to develop a new mission, it will become impossible for you to take on. You would, in fact, you may become strong in that mission, but you will become actually lame in terms of taking on something else. So don't misunderstand. I'm not for one moment suggesting that for the national S&T scene, copy the atomic energy or a space model. I'm only saying mission orientation, this kind of thing can be done more easily. And if you see a very important national mission, surely do that. But the larger S&T scene in the country, I think we should have in terms of linkages through in terms of a lot of this discrete organization. So I don't want to be misunderstood on that count. Now, in terms of as I said, funding is certainly an important determinator of priorities, and funding can certainly be used to bring people together and make groups work together. But it's not necessary that. You could have funding from one department, but departments or institutions working together, You could have multiple funding from different departments on a common identified program. I think both models can be pursued. I'm sure you are aware, between DAE and DST, we have an arrangement where all mega science project we look at together. We hold one meeting, joint meeting, where we decide, where university people are there, lab people are there. We decide these programs, and an approval from one place is honored on both the departments. So there are many ways. The important thing is to come together, and that's the main thing. Oh, General Saab, you are here.
these linkages and all you have worked on, these things have come through. But one or two things have been bothering me recently, and since there are executives from many departments. You see, in the wake of this 1, 2, 3, some seem to feel that technologies will come free. I don't mean free in the sense of free totally, but across borders. And I have heard this being expressed even by Brajesh Mishra and Mr. Sibal, which is not true. The US is very clear that technologies are not going to come across. This we have to work. And you know, there are certain technologies which can be worked only across departments. I am only hoping that with many of the people here and with this thing, that at least can be networked, and because that is holding up many of our activities. I hope those can be identified and in some way across departments. That's what, apart from the broader science.
No, I think we are absolutely true on the dot. Technology is a big word, and different people it conveys different meaning. As far as 1, 2, 3 is concerned, what we are going to do is we are going to pursue the three-stage program, the domestic program, exactly as it is. In fact, some bit faster, because I have said this time and again that without our competence in the three-stage program, this important aspect of three-stage program is it multiplies the energy that you can derive from uranium, or for that matter thorium, several tenfolds. And even for whatever you get from outside in terms of nuclear power, that is not going. You get 20,000 megawatt, 30,000 megawatt, 40,000 megawatt from outside. 40,000 megawatt is big business. But in terms of total electricity requirements in the long run, what does it mean? It means nothing. Because when the 40,000 megawatts in country would be producing maybe 2 lakh megawatts or 3 lakh megawatts. So, but the importance is same imported capacity can be multiplied at least a few tenfolds by way of using the domestic capability of recycle and building fast reactors and setting up more capacity without dependent on any additional uranium, either from within the country or from outside. So the importance of three-stage program, in fact, is enhanced in the new dispensation when the civil nuclear cooperation is opened up. So there is no question of diluting that priority. This is very clear. Now, surely nobody would, if I had said that you give us only uranium, we don't want your reactors, it would not have worked, because after all, work moves on business. So we are going to get uranium, we are also going to get reactors. We are also telling people that these reactors, to be competitive, you cannot manufacture everything there and bring it here. You can never. In fact, this is very clear to all vendors. That, and thanks to our own domestic program, if they have to compete with us, they have to reduce the capital cost. And the only way they can reduce capital cost is to manufacture those equipment here in India. And so we have told all vendors that if you want to make a success of your business in India, set up the supply chain in India. And you must have heard, this has already started happening. The companies are talking to each other. So a lot of manufacturing technology would flow from the vendors to Indian industries. Again, that does not mean that we become vulnerable or vulnerably dependent on that, because the manufacturing technology for domestic products, fast reactors, thorium reactors, that also is an ongoing stream. So we're talking about some technology coming in a domain where there's already considerable amount of what is described as background technology. And so I think we have to play our cards well. So I had no fear on that count. We're also insisting that we're talking about parks of several similar reactors at a given site. And by so doing, we're also saying that the entire technology of a reactor as a whole, I'm not talking about individual technology products, I'm talking about the reactor as a whole, that technology should stand transferred to India after 4 or 6 units of identical nature have been separated. And this is not too much to expect. This has happened in all international transactions. Today we say France is supplier of the reactor, but French technology came from Westinghouse. Same thing is true with Japan, same thing is true with Korea, and so on. So to that extent, the manufacture of PWRs, which are similar to what is supplied by vendor A, vendor B, vendor C, in future, it would be within Indian competence to do so in a completely independent manner. There is, of course, this issue of embedded technology for discrete components or products. And there is an IPR-related control on that. And there, the point which General Sundaram made is, I think, absolutely valid. And we have to have our work to make sure that there are no vulnerabilities.
The final question from Dr. Saiba.
Yes, listening to you, I've been thinking about the philosophy which you're proposing for the government. But then you partly answered the question which is lingering in mind. And if you have a system of the mission-oriented centers in this country demonstrating successfully to deliver the goals, will it be not prudent to identify some more trust areas for the development of this country and put them in this mode, take them to that level of success and leave it to that? And the second question is that though you mentioned that we have generous funding for the universities in R&D here, there is a gap and there is a need for regenerating these universities which are already there to take up the challenge for the development of our country.
Coming to second question first, I think regeneration of universities is an absolute must. I think the university funding has gone up quite a bit in particularly in recent years, including setting up of new institutions. But the fact still remains that while we require buildings and people and their salaries and the related infrastructure, we also require very vibrant and top-class research activity in our institutions of higher education. And that can happen only if there are very strong bridges between national programs or the laboratories engaged in research with universities. It is required for research funding, but it is also required because that is where you would get your new scientists from. And that's the task of the laboratories. I think laboratories must engage with universities. I would like to only highlight a model which also is showing very good promise. At At Bombay, there is this Institute of Chemical Technology, which was earlier Mumbai University Institute of Chemical Technology, and before that it was Bombay University Department of Chemical Technology. I believe that is the best chemical engineering institution in the country. And you look at it, any parameters, they are, I think, they're really at the top. We have a program between BARC, IGCAR on one side and Institute of Chemical Technology on the other. Under this program, there is provision for an X number of students to do their PhD. And then there is a support system for this entire activity. But equally importantly, this PhD, we have created a basket. We created a basket of problems that need to be solved, which are necessary for different elements in atomic energy program. That has been broken down into, I don't know, some 30, 40 such PhD activities. And we expect students, these students, to take one of them. And then there is a well-set coursework which they have to do, which is also specially designed to prepare students to do this kind of research. At the end of it, we expect there will be a lot of research activity. Of course, it's already there in UICT, but which will be even more specific to what we are doing in DAE. We would have a number of PhDs who would be ready at hand to get absorbed in DAE with a very high degree of competence, because they have worked on a very live program for their PhD. And so this, to my mind, is one good way of engaging universities, where you provide resources, you create a vibrant program, and you also bind the, what I call, the feet of young students to Indian roots, because they will work on the problems of the country. Of course, I am not saying that UICT is an underfunded institution. I think that institution, this is one institution which can attract, you cannot imagine how much, from private industry by way of their research support to corporate world. We need to create that kind of a competence. You know, this, you cannot do this kind of funding in an institution where there is no credibility. Or you may find some PhDs may come out, but you don't know what quality and whether they will be in a position to do that kind of work. So there has to be that capacity building, and I think the research labs must take part in that capacity building. Okay.
The course for senior executives is a flagship course of this institute. The concept and the evolution of this course owes a great deal to Dr. Rajaraman, the founder director of this institute. And this year, we received an unparalleled number of nominations for this course, for the first time, perhaps, since its inception. Seeing the diverse fields from which the executives have come and the significant positions they hold, I'm sure if Dr. Rajaramanna was with us this evening, the smile on his face would have been greater. Indeed, it's a great privilege to have had Dr. Anil Kakodkar with us this evening to give the fourth annual Dr. Rajaramanna Memorial Lecture. On behalf of all the esteemed course participants, family of Dr. Ramanna, associates, friends, and everyone in this audience, may I request the director of this institute, Dr. Kasturi Rangan, to gift a warm gesture in the form of a NIAS memento to Dr. Anil Kakodkar.